So our second speaker for today is going to be Dr. Hari Shroff. He is chief of the section on high-resolution optical imaging at the National Institute of Biomedical Imaging and Bioengineering. And he will tell us about his work developing super-resolution optical imaging techniques. Welcome, Dr. Shroff.
Thank you very much, Sean. And thank you to AAAS and to NIH for putting this event on. It's kind of fun to tell you about our work. I'm going to spend a brief amount of time today telling you about using a light microscope to convert a series of blurry diffraction-limited images, like the ones at the top of the slide, to much, much sharper images, so-called super-resolution images. But before I get into super-resolution, I think it's worthwhile to remind ourselves that, in fact, biology and life spans orders and orders of magnitude in length scales. There is no omniscient microscope, and so what might be appropriate for the protein level, like electron microscopy, is totally not going to work for the level of whole human beings. My area of expertise, fluorescence microscopy, falls somewhere between these two extremes. And so the first question I really have to answer before getting into high resolution is, well, why fluorescence? The reason historically has not been resolution. Fluorescence offers unmatched contrast and specificity. So with the advent of genetically encoded fluorescent proteins like GFP and small molecule labeling strategies and bright dyes, it's now possible to visualize one protein distribution in relationship to its neighbors inside a living cell or an animal, in fact. Furthermore, life has evolved to take use of the kind of relatively benign optical wavelengths we use in fluorescence, and so it's possible to do many of these experiments live. But there's a major problem, and that is diffraction. So even though you can use the tools of genetics to target fluorescent molecules like GFP with molecular precision to a target protein, much of that specificity is lost when you visualize a GFP molecule through an optical microscope. Instead, what you see is this diffraction-limited blob of light that is several hundred times larger than the protein itself. Why is this a problem? Well, if you have two molecules that are in close proximity within the diffraction-limited region, you can't resolve them anymore. And in biology, of course, we have tens of thousands of these proteins that are packed in the confines of a cell. So if, for example, you're interested in imaging these membrane proteins inside this bacterial cell, when you visualize that through an optical microscope, much of the high resolution information about where these proteins are is completely washed out at the diffraction-limited level. The good news is that as a biologist today, you're confronted with a whole sea of different techniques that circumvent this limit using optics, using light. And in the interest of time, I only have time to really focus on one class of these techniques that are based on localization of single molecules. So the sort of pioneering group of these techniques were POM, STORM, and FPOM, but there are also other techniques like STED and structured illumination microscopy that I mentioned that are very powerful also for circumventing the diffraction limit. Now, how do these localization-based techniques work? Luckily, they're actually quite easy to understand. The first thing to realize is that if you have just a single molecule that is emitting fluorescent light, you can localize that with essentially arbitrary precision given only by the signal-to-noise ratio of the image itself. So if the dye is sufficiently bright, then you can localize the center of that blob of light very precisely to a precision that is much better than the width of the blob. Similarly, in 3D, if you notice how the shape of the molecule changes as a function of depth, you can correlate that to the axial location and pin down the z-coordinate of the molecule also to well beneath the diffraction limit. But it turns out that localization is not enough, of course, because you might have many molecules fluorescing within a tight region of space. Really, the remaining thing you need is the ability to isolate individual molecules that are well separated from each other. So going back to this membrane protein example in the bacteria, if you had the ability to somehow turn on a few molecules that were well separated in space, well, then you could localize each one, turn them off, turn on a different subset of molecules, localize those, and repeat this sort of on and on and on until you build up, just by localizations, a much higher resolution picture than the initial diffraction-limited image. Now, the next question, of course, is how you actually perform this isolation in practice. And there are a growing number of ways to do this. I've just listed two ways. One thing you can do is take advantage of photo-switchable or photo-activatable molecules that are normally dark, but when you apply a pulse of UV light, can be switched to an activated bright state. The other strategy you can use is sort of a complementary approach. You can shine high-intensity light on a population of molecules that is initially bright and temporarily turn most of them off, so that only a few of them are fluorescing at a time. And then over time, you can sort of switch on some other ones and read out their locations. So these are two of the ways you can perform isolation. Now, in the remaining time, what I thought would be good is to pick a few biological examples that highlight information that can be obtained using these super-resolution imaging methods that couldn't be obtained any other way. So I'm going to start with an example on bacteria. Now, bacteria, as you know, are pretty small. And so if you're interested in, for example, membrane proteins that sense chemicals, chemoreceptors inside bacteria, if you visualize these with a diffraction-limited microscope, you see a rather blurry image like the ones at the top. You can see sort of the coarse spatial location of where these clusters are, but you don't know anything about where, about the sort of fine structure of how many are in a cluster. If you use a super-resolution technique like Palm or Storm, though, you can really get at where these proteins are within the membrane and how big the clusters are. So we see everything from single receptor complexes to tens of receptor complexes to whole macromolecular complexes that are visible at the poles of the cell. Now, taking this information is one thing, but you can actually use it to understand how these receptors distribute along the membrane. One very simple thing you can do is take the size distribution and plot that in a histogram. When you do that, you find that there's no preferred cluster size. In fact, you get this sort of stretched exponential distribution. Now, it turns out that you can explain that size distribution and also where these membrane receptors are with a few very simple assumptions. All you have to assume is that the membrane receptors are inserted in the membrane. They diffuse until they're captured by clusters of receptors, and that capture rate is dependent on the size of the pre-existing cluster. Importantly, you don't need to invoke cytoskeleton or active transport. So here's an example where we've actually taken the data from a super-resolution imaging method and used it to understand something about how these receptors got there in the first place. In sort of a second example, if you consider neurons, these are structures that can be visualized in a conventional light microscope. In fact, you can even visualize the spines, the sites of synaptic assembly, with a diffraction-limited optical microscope. But if you're interested in peering inside the spine and looking at the motion of molecules within the spine, well, then you're out of luck with a light microscope. And even an electron microscope is not good enough because the structure in that case is fixed. If, on the other hand, you use one of these photoactivatable strategies, you can switch on just a few molecules that are diffusing around in the spine, follow their trajectories, and build up tracks of the motion within the spine. So what I'm trying to show in the bottom of this slide is a few examples of actin molecules, both their starting positions in green and their ending positions in red, and the tracks they form within this living spine. If you follow enough tracks, you can start to get a sense of how the actin molecules move inside the spine, and you start to get these sort of velocity vector maps that are reminiscent of speckle microscopy that Claire will tell you about. One of the obvious things you see in these particular maps is inward motion away from the spine, but you also see regions of elevated molecular velocity within the spine. And this kind of heterogeneous velocity within the spine might reflect the diverse roles of actin in promoting spine function. Now, what about the sort of instrumentation for these techniques? Well, happily, they've been commercialized. So the kind of biological applications that I've just illustrated can all be done on commercially available microscopes from many vendors now. And I just want to emphasize that the field is continually being pushed to both deeper specimens and to higher resolution. So if, for example, you can confine the light via the two-photon effect or with a light sheet, you can, in fact, image structures that are about 100 microns larger than a single cell, like these cellular spheroids. If you use multiple objectives to collect more light, then you can push the resolution of these techniques down to sort of the 10 nanometer length scale. In this particular example, the authors investigated the upper and lower edges of the plasma membrane and observed different actin cytoskeletal arrangements in the top and the bottom. So this is sort of an evolving field. That being said, there are some caveats that any sort of super-resolution microscopist needs to appreciate. The first is that careful sample preparation is key in any of these microscopy techniques. So it's long been known at the diffraction-limited level that if you visualize a protein distribution live and then you fix it, you might observe profound differences, as I'm showing you in this top slide. These kinds of differences, if they're evident at the diffraction-limited level, will spring out at a higher level of resolution. And the most successful super-resolution studies ensue when the investigator is very cognizant of these kinds of effects and the protein distribution is well characterized at the diffraction-limited level. Now, the EM community is, of course, aware of the effect of different fixatives, and it's been known for a long time that subtly changing the chemical conditions can alter the composition of the sample. And again, these differences are often washed out in a light microscope, but become very evident in a super-resolution microscope. Now, if you have the luxury of visualizing structures live, that is to say, if the sample evolves slowly enough that you can track it with some of these super-resolution imaging methods, then at least you avoid the problems of chemical fixation. But of course, it takes time to build up super-resolution images. In this particular example, the movie at left is a much higher resolution view of focal adhesions as they flow backwards in the cell. But each frame in this time-lapse movie was required in 50 seconds, which is much, much longer than many biological phenomena of interest. And even if you can image things live, one has to worry about cell torture. So the fact remains that you have to apply much, much more light for extreme resolution in a light microscope than you would otherwise do in a normal diffraction-limited microscope. And so being cognizant of the kind of photo damage induced in a cell is very important. You want to avoid the cell sort of crumbling up like it is in this movie. One final technical point that I think often goes underappreciated is that extreme resolution requires extreme label density. To sort of drive that point home, in the top row, I have a bunch of test structures that are different squares. And in the left, there are grids that are very, very fine squares. And in the right, there are somewhat coarser grid patterns. And in the next two rows, I've deleted all but a fraction of the pixels. And I think you can see that if you delete the pixels, the very, very fine structures quickly sort of resemble noise and are much harder to define. So you need a very, very high label density if you want to make claims about very, very high resolution. This, in turn, has implications for the kind of dye you use in these super resolution experiments. That's the single most important factor in maximizing your resolution. So how is the dye attached? What kind of label density can you achieve? What sort of contrast ratio can you achieve between the bright and the dim state of the switchable molecule? And finally, is cramming all this dye into the sample perturbing the structure of the sample you're interested in? Now, I didn't have time to really get into the meat of these other two methods, but I'll just mention something about them in passing. Stimulated emission depletion microscopy, or STED, forces all the fluorescence except for a very narrow subdiffractive region within the point spread function radius off. And then this subdiffractive region is rastered throughout the sample to build up a super resolution image. This is very fast over small fields of view and can be applied to somewhat thicker samples like mouse brains. But the choice of dye like POM is critical, and you need very high intensities to get the highest resolution. Structured illumination microscopy is far more gentle on the sample. In its linear form, it only affords a factor of 2 resolution gain, but there are no label restrictions. So that brings me to a close, and I'd just like to thank everybody at the NIH that has supported me and importantly my lab. Thank you very much.
Great. Thank you so much, Dr. Shroff.